We're now going to talk about some other optimum lift distributions that can be developed in a very similar way to how the elliptic and Prandtl's bell-shaped lift distributions were developed. And that is by looking at lifting line theory and applying various constraints to our design problem and finding out what just falls out of the equations, okay? So let's just review really quickly. Last time we talked about two optimum lift distributions that are very well known. Those are the elliptic and what is often called the bell-shaped lift distribution. That's the one that Prandtl published in 1933. And then the elliptic was known before then, probably about 1918 or 1920, somewhere in there. And basically, those come from, let's just review some of the equations that we looked at last time. So this is a very important equation right here. This is a way of writing a non-dimensional lift distribution, okay? And we're going to retain that today. And then from lifting line theory, we can also write the induced drag. You can manipulate it. So you can write the induced drag in terms of the weight or the total lift that the wing is producing, the wing span, the density of the fluid, the velocity that the wing is traveling at. And then these BN parameters over here are Fourier coefficients that define the lift distribution up here. And those coefficients get summed and actually squared and then summed. And that all goes into the equation for the dimensional induced drag that is being produced. Okay, so these are two very important equations, and we're going to keep these in mind today as we walk through this problem. Okay, so I've copied these equations down so we can have access to them right here. So we've got those two equations here. Okay, so we've looked at this problem, and many other people have actually, of finding the optimum lift distributions for various design constraints. And so I'm going to go over a few that we found the last few years. And to start off on that path, we need to talk about some terminology here. Terminology. Okay, so a few things that we need to know. One of them is that we're going to use the capital W for what we're going to call the gross weight. Okay, so that's the total weight of the wing, including the structural weight and the non-structural weight. Okay, so let's define those as well. So W sub S is what we're going to call the structural weight. And that's the weight of basically the spar. We're only looking at offsetting the bending moments required. And so usually you do that with a spar. So anyway, when we talk about structural weight, mostly it's just the weight of a spar that is required to carry the bending moments at any location. But then we're also going to have a WN term here, which is any non-structural components. We're actually going to call that the net weight. Okay, so you can have other weight in a wing, like many wings will carry fuel. Often you put fuel in the wings, or maybe you have an engine sitting out there on the wing. So these are net weight components that are weight that we have to carry, but that are not not the structural weight. So actually, the gross weight is equal to the net weight plus the structural weight. Okay, and that's the gross weight up there. Okay, we're gonna also talk about the weight at the root. Okay. So the weight at the root is W sub R is actually the net weight at the root, okay? So this is the value of the net weight at the wing root, all right? Okay, so let's just draw a little picture over here of kind of what we're talking about here. So if we have, this is the center line of the wing, and then we have this is the span of the wing. And then let's just put kind of a lift distribution on here for a second. So that would be a force in the positive direction. Okay, so this would be some kind of a lift distribution that looks like this. So this is a force in the upward direction. Well, and by the way, Prandtl, that's the only load on the wing that he considered in his analysis, in his 1933 analysis. But today we're going to look at, well, we actually have some structural weight as well. And so let's say to offset those bending moments, we might have some structural weight that looks something like this. So I'm going to draw this as a force going down. Okay, so that, and then we'll just label this this is the W sub S term, okay, structural weight. And then we also have some net weight, and I'm going to put this in a different color here. Let's see, let's do this green here. So, and I'm going to add that to the structural weight, okay, so, and I'm just going to put it as kind of an arbitrary function here. And so this is the net weight that is also pointing down, and I'm drawing this in just, you know, 1G maneuver type of a thing. So this would be W sub N. Okay. So we have some net weight across the wing that's producing a load down. We have some structural weight that's producing a load down, and those get summed. And then we also have some lift here operating in the opposite direction here. So I'll say this is the lift distribution on the wing. Okay, so really when we're talking about the bending moments at any location, we have to consider both the lift in the positive direction and then the weights acting in the negative direction, at least if we're in a positive G maneuver. Okay, so speaking of Gs, let's talk about two more pieces of terminology here. That's what we're gonna call, so N sub M is what we're going to call the load factor for maneuvering flight. Okay, so this is a load factor. Little n is often used to denote a load factor, and then the sub m means for maneuvering flight. And that's when you hear that an aircraft is designed to 2.5 G's, for example, it's designed to take 2.5 to pull maneuvers that would make it feel like it weighs 2.5 times its normal weight. Okay, and so this is, in that case, N sub M here would be 2.5. That's a positive maneuvering flight load factor. Now, fighter aircraft are often designed up to somewhere around 9 G's. So the load factor, or N sub M, for fighter aircraft is much larger than for traditional general aviation aircraft, for example. Okay, so that's the load factor for maneuvering flight. And then we also have a load factor for a hard landing. Okay, and so this is another design case where it's another sizing case where we've got to look at the maximum stress or the maximum deflection when we hit the ground really hard. And so we call this the load factor at a hard landing. So a load factor for hard landing. Okay, so with all of that terminology now in place, let's talk about just a couple assumptions that that we applied. So assumptions. And really, this is there's two main ones that I want to just point out here. And of course, you'd want to read through the papers that we've published on this to maybe dig in and understand this a little bit more. But I just want to point out two very important assumptions that we made in our analysis. The first one is a specific weight distribution, and actually a specific non-structural or a net weight distribution. So I'm going to call this WN distribution. So WN is a function of Z if we use Z out along the span here, okay? So this is a specific net weight distribution that we assumed. It turns out we think this is a fairly ideal net weight distribution. This is probably the way that you would want to distribute the net weight within your wing if you had full flexibility. So remember, net weight here is the weight of any non-structural component. So we don't have control over where the structural weight is because that's a complete function of the design of the wing here. But net weight, that's like the fuel in the wings, where we do engine placement, things like that. So if you have full control over that, There's probably an optimum way you want to distribute that in the wing, and it's probably according to this equation here. So what we assumed is that Wn tilde of z, that net weight distribution, is equal to capital W minus W sub r, so that's the total weight minus weight at the root, times L tilde, so this is the local lift at any location z, divided by the total lift, minus W tilde of S, so the structural weight at that location Z, okay? So this is, you don't need to get too hung up on this, but this is just a net weight distribution that we assumed. And also, while we're talking about weight distributions, we also assumed that the weight at the root is always equal to NG minus 1 divided by NM, that's an M there, plus NG times W, okay? So these are two things that just have to do with the weight distribution. So we're specifying a certain weight at the root that depends on the load factors that we're sizing to. So this is our landing load, N sub G, for the hard landing, and then N sub M is our maneuver load. And then of course this non-structural weight distribution or net weight distribution. Okay, so again, these are, we think, ideal distributions if you have complete control over how much weight you have at the root and how much you have in the wing or how that's distributed. You probably want to do it according to this. And we assumed for all these lift distributions or optimum cases that it was distributed that way. Okay, and then one other assumption that we need to point out here is we specifically assumed a rectangular plan form, and that we're getting these different lift distributions by twisting the wing, for example, and that's important because it simplifies the math. And now we have done some studies that relaxed that constraint and said, okay, we're not going to look at rectangular plan form, we're going to look at a tapered wing. And it turns out that the solutions don't change that much. The problem is, in order to get an analytic solution, we basically had to assume a rectangular plan form. We couldn't find a way to get an analytic solution, meaning that we could work through the equations by hand if we didn't assume a rectangular plan form. So these solutions that we're going to go over today all assume this rectangular plan form, but we have done numerical solutions, so you can still solve the problem if you don't have a rectangular plan form, but you have to solve it numerically. And we've done that as well and shown that actually the solutions don't deviate very much. Even if you have some taper in the wing, the solutions that we're going to show today really are not much different than what you would get even on tapered wings. So anyway, it's not too significant of an issue. I just wanted to point it out that we are assuming a rectangular plan form for all of this analysis. Okay, so let's come back up here and just highlight again. So this is our fundamental equation that we're trying to minimize. And previously, you know, if we go back to the elliptic lift distribution, for example, the way that you get there is you assume that W is set. So you hold the W constant and the wingspan constant. And then you say that all of these are these BN variables that describe your lift distribution can be varied. And of course, the solution then to minimize the induced drag is to set all of those to zero. And then you get the elliptic lift distribution. So if you plug in Bn equals zero up here, this term goes away for all of these Bn terms. And so you're left with this 4 over pi times sine of theta. And this right here is the elliptic lift distribution. Okay, so that's one solution if we assume that W is fixed and the wingspan is fixed, and that the lift distribution here can be altered independent of affecting the weight of the wing. Well, as we've talked about, the weight of the wing, the total weight of the wing is a summation of the net weight and the structural weight. And so we can see that as we change the lift distribution over here, the structural weight is gonna have to change, right? So if you change this lift distribution, the structural weight required to offset the bending moments here is going to change. And so that factors into this capital W here. And so these are actually related. The lift distribution and the weight are related, and they're related differently depending on what your constraints are for your problem. So, but anyway, let me come back down here for a second and just make a few notes here for things that we're going to find here. So one of them is that although we have this lift distribution can have an infinite number of terms in it, these Fourier coefficients, we're going to find that when we made this assumption to go with only rectangular planforms, all of our solutions came out, the weight of the structure was only a function of B3, okay? And this is just for rectangular planforms. So only B3 factors into the weight of the structure. And that was something kind of surprising to us, but that was one of the products of assuming a rectangular planform. Well, what that means, because that's the only part, B3 here, if we come back to this equation, if B3, that third Fourier coefficient, is the only one that affects W, then we want the rest of those to go to zero to minimize induced drag no matter what, because none of them are ever going to do us any good or make any difference to this total weight over here, okay? So in that case, so I'm just going to write that down here, is that we always want B sub n equals zero for n not equal to 3, okay? So B3 is the only Fourier coefficient that we ever want to be non-zero, at least for our set of conditions here, okay? So this is, again, for rectangular wings. So I'll just write that down here, for rectangular wings. Okay? Because of that, let's just write down a simplified lift distribution here. And actually, it's just, you know, this exact same equation here, but because we know that for our set of solutions, we're only going to have a third Fourier coefficient in here, let's just rewrite this equation here in terms of that, just that third Fourier coefficient, okay? So we're going to look at lift distributions that can be written like this. So we have wingspan times the local lift at any theta location divided by the total lift is equal to 4 over pi times sine of theta plus, and we only have a B3 term, times the sine, that's the third Fourier coefficient, so we have a 3 in here, 3 theta, and close bracket, okay? So this is the family of lift distributions that we're going to be looking at that only vary by this one term here, B3, okay? And we're going to look at different values of B3 that that produce a family of optimum lift distribution. So actually, we already know two of them. So for the elliptic, B3 equals zero. For the bell-shaped lift distribution that Prandtl came up with, B3 equals -1/3. Okay, so those are already two within this family of lift distributions. That are two optimum lift distributions that we already know about that only vary by that one parameter B3. And we're going to look at that B3 and we're going to find some other values of B3 that minimize the induced drag for different sets of design constraints.